is a Steinbock. I can just see that you've spotted. Got it? There we go. Okay, get ready, Brian. Get ready. Get ready. Go. She's talking. So there's probably 35 meters, but quite open ground for her to go. So, a Steinbok is one of Kruger's favorite preys. Oh, I think it spotted it. It's off. So the Steinbok ran off, and you can see she's changed her. She's just walking now. I think she's probably going to make her way towards that big termite mound. I keep with her. Maybe she'll head towards quarantine. So she's just using that termite mound to peer over the top. I'm just going to stop as soon as we get a nice clear view of her again. There she is, using that termite mound for a bit of height. Maybe still trying to check where that Steinbok ran to. For those who might have been joining a bit late, like A. Imam, welcome to the Sunrise Safari. It has been spectacular. We've had Karula and Shadow in the same sighting, sort of scent marking opposite each other. They now have gone their separate ways. We lost Shadow in the drainage line in Arethusa, so we came back to spend some time with Karula, who's now moving deeper into Juma. Very observant viewer in Ohio, Rain, who's 15 years old. Rain has noticed that little shimmering and twitching on the side of a leopard, and Rain would like to know, why do leopards do that? And it's really, really fascinating. They do that to keep the flies off their body. We saw something very strange with Karula this morning, or the first time I've ever seen it, but she blew a perfect bubble and held it there for a good 4 minutes or so before it popped. chair. She's going to walk right past us. Stalking again. She is heading into that area where that stem book ran off. But I didn't see it. Scent mark. And now we had two leopards together this morning and they both moved off. And Joel from the Big Apple would like to know, because Karula moved off, did she lose the fight with Shadow? Well, Joel, they both moved off. So I would say it was more of a stalemate. And I think the boundary that they've had traditionally for quite some time now will stay the same. They've probably been rivals for quite some time. Quest, sorry, incorrect word there. Succeed sections of their territory to their female offspring. And over time, female leopards' territory gets smaller and smaller as they have more female offspring. And towards the end of their lives, they're often operating in a very small area. And there's been some very interesting research done by Panthera in the Sabi Sands about this. And a leopard I used to see quite often called the Mvomba female in the southern Sabi Sands. And you could see over the years how her territory shrunk and shrunk and shrunk. And then Karula's still okay. She's probably got another good couple of years before she completely loses her territory or shrinks to an area that's not viable for her to utilize. And so she's 11, she's probably got at least another one or two litters in her. In this area, the female leopards do quite often get to 15 and older, which is really unusual in the wild. So we're just gonna shoot her on ahead, catch her coming up to the road. Can you spot it yet, Brian? It should be popping out over here. Yeah, turn on. Okay, she's gone up the turnout mountain. Thank goodness for the eyes of Brian there, otherwise I would have carried on past. From Illinois, she thinks the left hind leg is limping. It looks a little stiff, and I don't see too much of a big limp. I'm just sent Mark for Torchwood. She's a beautiful cat. isn't this wonderful being able to spend so much time with these leopards again? And she's just behind me. I'm going to wait for her to move a little bit before I try to drive. Oh, yeah, it's too long.
And see which way she goes. So from the tracks I had this morning, she walked right past our camp and right up the main access at Juma access. It doesn't look like she not quite. Where are you gonna go, left or right? All straight into the middle of the block. Lovely, yeah, that tip of the tail just flicks from side to side. And let's try to keep up with that. We've got a question, and I didn't quite hear the name there, but what is the difference between a leopard and a jaguar? And jaguars are much, much bigger. Mokan, there we are, it's from Mokan, and big male jaguar would be sort of the size of a lioness, and the main difference is that they live in very different areas. So jaguar are endemic to from the southern United States down through into South America, where there's leopards occur all the way through Africa into India, China, Russia, and at one stage occurred even in Europe. So we do get incredibly close to these big cats out here, and Susan from New York is wondering how close can you get and what's safe and what's not. Well, Susan, what happens is these animals are actually grown up with vehicles, and if you drive carefully and respectfully around them, there is a point that you can push them to become unhappy with you, and it's much better to stop a little bit further away and let the animal come close to you rather than you going close to the animal. And again, it's all reading the animal's body language and behavior to try and see what's the right thing to do. And fortunately, we've got lots of experience and spent lots of time with these animals. So we do know the little signs they give you when they're starting to get upset. And that's when you either leave them alone or just stay quite far away from them. Mate called Tundi, and Gwen would like to know why that leopard isn't in that area. Well, Tundi has taken over a different section of Kruger's territory. So Shadow's got the west and Tundi's got the south. So they do see her. We don't see her in the area we operate. She is further south than that. Looks like she might be heading down towards quarantine. So, it's always wonderful when we've got cubs around, and we haven't had leopard cubs for quite some time. And Katie and Odin always wondering what's the average size of a litter. Normally there are two, Katie. Sometimes three, but normally two. But leopards have a very high mortality rate for their first year of life. It's about 70% in the Sabi Sands. So most of them will die within that first year. And quite interestingly, the ones where we know, the Panthera know exactly what killed them, the biggest killer of leopard cubs is male leopards. So male leopards, nomadic young males that are moving and looking for territory, or dominant males that find cubs that aren't their own. So very, very interesting that. Karula's definitely on the hunt at the moment, and Michael's wondering, is there a preferred time of day that leopards like to hunt? Well, generally they do quite a lot of their hunting after dark, so from dusk onwards, and also from the early morning. But leopards, like most predators, are complete opportunists. So if something happened to stumble on them in the heat of the day, they would. Karula seems to do quite a lot of daytime hunting compared to the other females, and she tends to walk around quite a lot during the day. I think she's looking for baby impala at the moment. She's smelling something on that grass stalk. Could be many things. Definitely not another leopard scent mark. She would have showed the Fleming grimace, taking that scent over the Jacobson's organ if it had been. She spotted something we can't see. Hey, just stopping and listening. She might be listening for that burp, 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 burp of a female and baby impala. Oh, now see, she heard me. And this time of the year, leopards are huge fans of the baby impala. From Man in the Lone Star State, Texas. Man would like to know, what is Karula's maximum speed and how far might she chase a potential prey species for? So, leopard's maximum speed is around 24 meters per second, which is around 90 kilometers an hour. And they generally will not chase for much further than about 20 meters at the most. They are ambush predators. They normally will only go after, they'll stalk up until about 5 meters before they pounce. Just stopping, listening. So I'm trying to listen to see if I can hear any impala or anything. Nothing yet. So Wolfkiss would like to know whether leopards will mate with other cats or just leopards. Generally, they would only mate with other leopards, and it is possible for them to mate with other cats, but it is only if they are forced to by humans putting them into the same sort of environment. And most of the birds from anything like that will be sterile, and like ligers and things like that. And it's generally very, very cruel to try to force unrelated species to mate. And it's a very much a human fascination. Animals will stick to their own species if they have the choice. On the move again. Put poor Brian in the thorn tree again. Twitching slightly. Now you can see that bright white tip. It's a following mechanism for when she does have babies. And very, very, very distinct, so that leopard young cubs can follow mom. Matt, who's in LA, is saying, well, if Karula's 11 and Shadow's 9, have they had any other litters in the last couple of 8 years? Yes, Matt. Karula is probably one of the most successful mothers around. She's had multiple litters. A 6. I might be wrong there. So if I am wrong, please correct me. About 6 litters. Shadow, unfortunately, has not been a very good mother. And she has not successfully raised any offspring to adulthood. Her last young cub was just over a year. And he happened to, unfortunately, kill a domestic dog that tested positive for rabies. So he had to be removed from the reserve for safety to all the other animals and people, and is in quarantine. And we're waiting to hear what's happening there. Area to drive through than the shadow was trying to take us. Still got her bike? Turn my motor on. Yeah. Karula is quite predictable with when she is moving through the bush like this. If there is a termite mound where she can get a bit of height,
she will use it. Go a bit wider.
There you go.
That's too close to her. As I said, it's far more important to let them come close to you than you go close to them. To warm up quite heavily, and you see even on Tulaman like that, she tries to keep her head profile lower than the highest point of the termite mound, and you'll quite often find leopards sneak up to the termite mounds and just pop their head over the top, and it looks like it could just be another column of the termite mound. Leopards are the most widespread of the big cats in Africa. And Lisa in California is wondering, are they endangered? At the moment, out of all the big cats in Africa, they're probably the least endangered. That still doesn't mean they're completely not under threat, but they occur over a very widespread area. And some of the biggest threats to them is poaching for the skins. For a certain church called the Shembe Church in South Africa, all members of the church must wear a leopard skin, and I think there's over a million people in that church. Sorry guys, just be on the game drive radio for a second. Copy legs. Thanks for staying with it. So that is one of the biggest threats, and there's now a push by Panthera to have fake leopard skins made for the church members. So a synthetic fur. There's millions of people, everyone wanting to wear a leopard skin. We're going to run out of leopards. But in the wild areas, there's still lots of leopards. They are the most adaptable of the big cats as well. And in certain areas, they'll feed off fish, they'll feed off grasshoppers, termites. They are able to sort of really get by, even if there isn't large prey around. We can see the wild quite nice and clearly now. Of course she turns her head. But if you look carefully, you can see the spelling of wild. The W is standing out very nicely. So it'll be interesting to see, is she gonna lie up now or is she gonna continue to hunt? This is Karula. She does move when it is really hot, which is quite unusual I think a lot of people used to think it was very unusual for leopards, but what we've seen is that the leopards in this part of the world do often move during the heat of the day, both male and female. She's walking right past us. She's less than 6 feet from us now. And we've been chatting about how female leopards will give some of their territory to their daughters. And now it's
direction. I'm pretty sure the wine is.
Berlin is in Texas. Do they also give some of their territory to their male offspring? They don't, Berlin. The male offspring need to move along. If they did, they would end up mating with direct relatives of theirs, half sisters and full sisters and mothers. So they generally, at about two years old, will become completely independent and move away. So while we keep following through that, Jamie's got something with scales to show you.
Look what we have found in our exploration of this drainage line. Two incredibly beautiful agamas with their bright blue heads. There's one on the top of the left, and there's one down a little bit further. Oh, it'd be interesting to see if this is a male or a female. These animals are very highly territorial. That bright blue color means it's breeding time. It could be two males fighting for territory. And this is the perfect territory. Did you catch something there? Almost looked like he did. Really rapid movement of his head. Look at those beautiful colors. Our leadwood tree like this one, it's enormous. It's teeming with insect and other life. It'd be the perfect spot, full of hidey holes. And definitely one of my favorite trees. I think if I were a tree agama, I'd live in a leadwood. Watch and see how they interact. Keeping their distance from each other. When they first arrived, they were right next to each other, and then one scuttled off a bit further up. And this is such a beautiful setting. Look at the length, that width of the tree. We're going to go up. I'm just looking for ants. Yeah, he's catching, he's hunting things. I think he just caught a fly there. Lots and lots of them buzzing around at the moment, and if they're not busy being eaten by agamas, then they spend the rest of their time biting us. Stable flies. And it could be what he's hunting, stable flies and Mopani bees. Amazing how still they can sit and look completely almost half asleep, half dozing, and then that lightning fast reflex movement to catch the insects that fly past. One at the top to me has a slightly bigger, darker blue head, and I wouldn't be surprised if that's the male and it's a female lower down. It's either a female or a younger male. Awesome stuff. Let's watch this. They're definitely not competing with each other. Otherwise, we would have seen some reaction from our remaining agama. Right, well, we're going to continue on our search along the drainage line, but I know that Brent is still with the wonderful Queen of Juma, so let's head back across to him.
So, she's moved to another termite mound. She's perusing down towards the lower slopes of the drainage line that's on the western edge of Quarantine. And this area normally has quite a lot of impala, and I think that's what she's looking for this morning. Leopards are incredibly agile, and Fanny from Texas wants to know how high can they jump. I've seen leopards jump up to sort of 20 feet in one leap, and trying to catch a bird out of the air. It almost looks like she's giving herself a little back tickle with her tail there. Multi-uses. And you can see that movement is completely different from the movement we had when she was with Shadow this morning. It's a non-aggressive tail movement, that one. Contact calls between female and parlor and babies. Almost looks like she might have seen something, but we can't see it. Let's get my binoculars out. Have a look down where she's looking. See if I can pick up a flick of a tail or something through the bush. Can't see anything yet, and her eyes are so specifically designed to pick up little bits of movement. Woodland's kingfisher calling. Summer is well and truly here. Baby impala, woodlands kingfishers. Now next, we shall be waiting for the baby wildebeest. And what a great way to start today's sunrise safari. I always love it when we find fresh tracks and we're able to follow those tracks to eventually put a leopard inside them. Female leopards in the same sighting this morning, and Joel in New York's wondering, would they share a meal or hunt together if something happened to stumble upon them in that situation? Joel, I think not. I think they probably wouldn't be too concerned with hunting when they're two of them right on a sort of in a territorial dispute. And generally, the only time you will see leopards sharing a meal is a female and her cubs, and occasionally a male and his cubs, or cubs he thinks are his at least, but even then that's very unusual, and most of the time a big male leopard will actually just steal the kill from the females. Definitely very intent on something to the north of us, or northeast. And she's off again. Now watch carefully how her back foot almost falls in the exact same spot as her front foot. And not so much now, but when they do stalk, they will put their back foot in the exact same position of the front foot to try avoid making any extra noise. Thank you. got another question from Mo Khan in Gunya. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. Mo Khan, can you let me know where Gunya is? That would be really fascinating to know. And he'd like, so are there animals that see in black and white? Yes, Mo Khan, most animals see in black and white out here. Leopard included. She actually stopped in a little sort of section of round leaf teak behind a silver cluster leaf using available cover. There's not much grass at this time of the year. This is very typical hunting behavior. Move a little bit, stop, listen, smell, move again. I see it, there's impala. She's seen it as well. So directly down the road up in front of her, Brian. There's a male impala. I don't know if she has seen it. There's impala there. Probably 50 meters, maybe a bit more than 50 meters, 60 meters. Is that just a bachelor group? Male impala is quite a big prey for Karula. She is a small female. Probably weighing around 100 pounds. Maybe a little bit less than 100 pounds, 90 pounds. But pure muscle. Quite interesting to see what she does from here. I think she might move into that bit thicker bush on the left-hand side of the road. But leopards are incredibly patient. Sometimes they'll just lie down and wait for the impala to come close to them. I only saw one impala there. I didn't see any females. Birds. And there we go, she's gonna go towards, there's some big termite mounds up ahead. She knows those impala are still quite far away, so she is still scent marking. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna move past her. Ravi, I will get back to your question in a second. So I don't want the impala to look at the car and see her, so are we still far away? We're just gonna move past her and go wait ahead and rather be in the right position for us to walk, for her to walk towards us, and we will sit around where the impala are. Okay, so there are some female impala here as well, so there should be some babies. We're gonna turn around, although I think her game might be up. This female looked like might be looking towards her. Okay, Impala spread out through the bush over here. Karula is 50, 60 meters away. Like that. So we can see Karula and the Impala. It's going to be interesting to see. I think she might not hunt now as it gets a bit warmer. She might just lie down and wait for the Impala to move towards her. And you can see she almost looks like a stump from this distance. So Robbie, while we're chatting there, there she is. It's most likely that while we've been with her, there haven't been any squirrels or birds around to spot her. If there had been, they would have been shouting. Some of the squirrels might still be sleeping. It's been quite early in the morning, and she just happened not to disturb any birds. Look how stock still she's standing. Milling about. She's keeping very, very still. So this is one of those things, patience is so important with these animals. Spending time with them and trying to be as unobtrusive as possible. See, if I were her, I would move across the road to what is now the right-hand side of the road. There's some thickets there, lie up there and wait for them pilot, because they seem to be moving in that direction. Michael's wondering, do they hunt more at night? They do, sort of from dusk onwards and also in the early hours of the morning, but they do also hunt during the day. And leopards in this area seem to do quite a bit of moving and hunting during the day. Karula specifically, I know, moves a lot during the day, a lot more than most other leopards I've seen. And there's Impala have just slowly moved off towards that marula tree there. And Karula's on the move again, going the opposite way to which I recommended her, but she probably knows better than I do. And as I said, I think it might be getting a little warm now. She might be looking for a spot to stop. I think she's going to go straight for that termite mound. Find a nice shady spot to rest up in. Shade on the back side of the termite mound. She might be looking to have a little bit of a rest towards her during the day. While she's asleep or doing a bit of grooming, let's go see what Jamie's been up to.
Well, look at what we found. Isn't this incredible? It was actually spotted by the wonderful Tara. looks like a dead... Oops, sorry, move my head out of the way. Looks like a dead cobra to me, just by the shape of its head. With an ant wandering along, looking very confused. To the tip of the nose. This is so fascinating to see, the way that the vertebrae all link together. I don't know what killed it. I can't figure it out. It doesn't look like it's got any injuries. It hasn't been eaten. It's a perfectly intact, right from the tip of the tail to the top of the head, all curled up in its last position. You can see the ribs there as the ant tries desperately to crawl down them. Absolutely incredible. Fascinating anatomically. I'm just trying to estimate how many different individual vertebrae there are here. I'm not sure if it's a set number for the different species of snakes or not. Must be. And they must just grow with it. The reason it's on a plastic bag on our dashboard is because it's actually quite gross. Although it is dry and not too smelly, I don't really want to be touching it with my bare hands. I'm going to turn it so we can have another look at the head. Attempt to. The fangs are gone, the lower jaw is gone. That is so, so cool. Still with the residual scales of the head and the eye. What a fascinating thing. Now, this is definitely coming home with me, and I'm going to put it up high out of hyena reach and leave the ants to do finish off their decomposition work. Now, usually if you're prepping skeletons or skulls, you can boil them to get rid of any of the rest of the body so that you're left with the bones. But with this particular snake, I really don't want to do that, because let me tell you something, piecing this back together would be like the worst jigsaw puzzle in the world. It would be absolutely impossible. Awesome. Really, really cool. Just judging by the color as well, I think it was a cobra of some sort. Quite an old one. It's quite a long snake. If I were to stretch that out from top of nose to tip of tail, it would probably be over the length of my arm, it's probably about a meter long. Really, really cool. I'm going to very delicately fold it. Try not to break it in any way, but I also don't really want it touching anything. Quite important to be careful with old bones like this. There we go. Right, well, amazing what you can find in a drainage line. I'm really glad we came down here. It's actually been a beautiful way to spend our morning. It's just exploring all of the little things that we find out here. The poor ant is now very much still lost. It's on my steering wheel. Hey, buddy. There you go. Okay. Ant is back. Returned to nature. And no longer racing around the steering wheel in a constant motion that would probably continue forever. So that snake that the ant was on, Gary, you were wondering if that was a venomous species. Yes, I think so. It's difficult because cobra's nose shape is shared by a couple of non-venomous species. Cobras, the cobra family, are some of the most venomous snakes we have. Now, I would say that 95% of snakes are completely harmless to man. There are a couple of species, the spitting cobra and the snouted cobra, are both very dangerous cobra species that you'll see regularly in this area, as well as the Cape cobra, which is further towards the west. And then, as is very popularly known, the most dangerous would be the black mamba, just in terms of the potency of their venom. Puff adders are the ones responsible for the most bites, but that's because they're very inactive snakes. They don't tend to move away from the threat, and they're also the most widely distributed. So they're not necessarily the most aggressive, they just come into contact with humans the most. The most potent venom of any snake out here is a worm slug. But the chances of you being bitten are so slim, they're beautifully relaxed. I'm sure many of our regular viewers will have seen that incredible sighting of the worm slug that Brent had on foot, where he spent an extended period of time, almost an hour with that snake, watching it move through the trees. and it was completely relaxed in his presence. But if that was a dead cobra, its venom is neurotoxic, so it affects the nerves, it paralyzes the victims. And if it was a spitting cobra, it also has an element of cytotoxic venom, so cell-destroying venom. And the reason behind that is because they spit. That's why they're called spitting cobras. So it becomes a useful way of blinding the prey item by spitting at it.